this week, Ed Bishop stars in Legal Rites by Isaac Asimov and James Maccreag. Dramatized for radio by Patricia Mays.
Place hasn't changed. Still mean. Still uncharitable. What's that? Who's there? Water. Water dripping somewhere. No. It's not water. It's blood. My God, blood dripping from nowhere.
Get off my land.
Bartender, don't stand there staring at me, bartender. For Christ's sake, give me a whiskey, will you?
Well, he's staring at you because you got blood all over your clothes.
I've just been scared out of my life. Hey, who the hell are you?
Here's your drink. No, it's okay, Frank. I'll take care of our friend here.
Oh, Christ, man, what is so funny, huh?
Well, as soon as I heard you'd hired a local car and were going to Harley Hall, I knew you were Zeb Harley's no-good nephew come to take Harley Hall and sell it before he was cold in his grave.
How did you know? Where did you come from?
Name's Nichols. Would you like to follow me?
Huh?
I think I can be of service to you.
In what way?
As a ghost exterminator.
I'm sorry, Mr. Nichols. I don't like it. I never had anything to do with ghosts. How do you know this stuff will work?
You'll have to take my word for it. I've had dealings with ghosts before.
I still don't like it.
You kind of like the prospect of owning Harley Hall, though, don't you? And looking for all the money your late uncle is supposed to have hidden around here, don't you?
Now that's where you come in, is that it? I find the money that I own anyhow and give some of it to you. How much?
We'll discuss that later.
Well, we'll discuss it right now.
No, we won't. I'm doing you a favor, Harley. Remember that. In return, you'll do as I say. All the way.
I was out here once when the old man was alive. He didn't say nothing about any ghost.
Well, perhaps he felt that you might think him peculiar. And perhaps you would have. When were you here?
Oh, a long, long time ago. I was here a whole day and part of the night. The old man was crazy as a coot, but he didn't keep any ghosts in the attic.
Well, this ghost was a friend of his. Your late uncle lived in Harley Hall, miles from anywhere, hardly ever came into town, and wouldn't let anyone get friendly with him, except for old Hank. Didn't mind his company.
Some company.
I don't know. From all accounts, they got on well together. Played pinochle, chess. Hank's supposed to have been a great pinochle player. He was killed that way, according to local reports.
Huh?
Caught someone dealing from the bottom of the pack and shot it out with him. He lost. A bullet pierced his throat. He died in a pool of blood. Gushed out of him just like a fountain. Ah, here we are. And that accounts for the blood that accompanies his apparition. Give me a hand with this stuff, will you?
Excuse me. You're making more than a little mess on the carpet.
Damn it, man. Is your carpet all you can think of? I may be a ghost, but heaven knows I'm not trying to haunt you. I'm here on business.
Business?
You're a lawyer, aren't you?
Yeah.
The fact that I was once killed by violence and have to continue my existence on the astral plane doesn't mean I've lost my legal rights, does it?
This would be easier for me if you weren't invisible. Can't you do something about that?
Well, I could materialize for a minute. It's hard work. Damn hard for me. There are a lot of astral entities that can do it as easily as falling out of bed, but... Well, I'll try and do it once. Stand back. How's that?
I can just see you.
I'm way out of practice. I guess that's the first daylight materialization I've made in 75 years.
I think I'm going mad.
What?
Nothing. I'm just a small-town lawyer, you know. My business is, was until now, fairly routine.
I know all about your business. You can handle my case. It's a land affair. I want to sue Russell Harley.
I understand the attorneys for both sides have waived jury trial in this case of Henry Jenkins versus Russell Joseph Harley. In view of the unusual nature of this case, I imagine it'll prove necessary to conduct it with a certain amount of informality. Sole purpose of this court is to arrive at the true facts at issue and to deliver a verdict in accord with the laws pertaining to these facts. Counsel for the plaintiff will begin.
Your Honor, we propose to show that my client, Henry Jenkins, has been deprived of his just rights by the defendant. Mr. Jenkins, by virtue of his sustained residence of more than 20 years in the house located on Route 22, 8 miles north of the town of Rebel Butte, with the full knowledge of its legal owner, has acquired certain rights. In legal terminology, we define these as the rights of adverse possession. The layman would call them common law rights or squatter's rights.
Squatter's rights, did you say, Mr. Turnbull?
Yes, Your Honor.
For a ghost?
Yes, Your Honor.
Continue.
Upon the death of Zebulon Harley, the owner of the house involved, it is perhaps better known as Harley Hall, the defendant inherited the title of the property. We do not question his right to it. But my client has an equity in Harley Hall, the right to full and free occupation of it for the full duration of his existence. The defendant has forcefully evicted my client by means which have caused him great mental stress and have endangered his very existence. I would, therefore, Your Honor, like to call Henry Jenkins to the stand.
Objection. The so-called Henry Jenkins cannot qualify as a witness.
Why not?
Because he's dead. All right, order. Order in the court, please. Order.
Naturally, Mr. Wilson, you will have proof of that statement.
Certainly, Mr. Turnbull. The so-called Henry Jenkins is the ghost, spirit, or specter of one Hank Jenkins, who prospected for gold in this territory a century ago. He was killed by a bullet through the throat from the gun of one Long Tom Cooper and was declared legally dead on September 14th, 1850, exactly 100 years ago.
Your Honor... Your Honor, Henry Jenkins was tested by John Quincy Fitzjames, professor of psychology at the University of Southern California. The results, I have Dr. Fitzjames' sworn statement of them here, which I will introduce as an exhibit, show clearly that my client's intelligence quotient is well above normal, and that a psychiatric examination discloses no important aberrations which could injure his validity as a witness and thereby take the oath. I insist that my client be allowed to testify.
But he's dead. He's invisible right now.
All right, order. Order in the court. Mr. Wilson, if these experts who prepared these reports will testify on the stand to the facts contained in them, Henry Jenkins may then take the stand, providing he can materialize long enough. Well, we'll have a brief recess and... Then you may call your witness, Mr. Turnbull.
I feel like a fool, suing a ghost.
The ghost brought the suit, not you. If only we'd been able to hold fire for another couple of weeks, till another judge came on the bench. Gimble hates my guts.
Why couldn't we have waited?
Because you were in such a damned hurry. You and that idiot Nichols. So confident that it would never come to a trial.
And so confident was Nichols that he could hold him in that circle of his with all his paints and potions.
Where is Nichols?
I don't know. The last I saw him was in your office. He came round to see me after the deputy slapped the show cause order on me at the house. He brought me down to you. Said you'd been recommended to him. Lent me a little money to help meet your retainer. I haven't seen him since.
Your name?
Henry Jenkins.
Your occupation?
Well, I have none. I guess you'd say I'm retired.
And Mr. Jenkins, just what connection have you with the building referred to as Harley Hall?
I knew Zeb quite well.
When did you make his acquaintance?
In the spring of 1907. Zeb had just lost his wife. After that, you see, he made Harley Hall his year-round home. We became friendly after that.
Mm-hmm. How long did this friendship last?
Until he died last fall.
In all your years of association, did Zebulon Harley ever ask you to leave or pay rent?
Of course not. Not Zeb.
Very good. Now, just one or two more questions. Will you tell me in your own words what occurred after the death of Zebulon Harley that caused you to bring this action?
Well, in January, young Harley...
You mean Russell Joseph Harley, the defendant?
Yeah. He arrived in Harley Hall on January 5th. I asked him to leave, which he did. On the next day, he returned with another man. They placed a talisman upon the threshold of the main entrance and further added an exclusion circle with a radius of a little over a mile entirely surrounding the hall.
Which effectively barred you from the house you had occupied for 90 years.
That is correct.
Thank you. That's all. Your witness.
You say your name is Henry Jenkins.
Yes.
That is your name now, you mean to say. What was your name before?
Before? Before what?
Don't pretend ignorance. Before you died.
Objection. The counsel for the defense has no right to speak of some hypothetical death of my client.
Objection sustained.
You say, Mr. Jenkins, that you occupied Harley Hall for 90 years?
92 years next month. The hall wasn't built in its present form, anyhow, until 1876, but I occupied the house that stood on the site previously.
What did you do before then?
Before then? I don't remember.
Well, let's see if I can refresh your memory. It is true that 91 years ago, in the very year in which you claim to have begun your occupancy of Harley Hall, Hank Jenkins was killed in a gun duel.
Well, that may be true if you say so. I don't remember.
Well, do you remember that the shooting occurred not 50 feet from the present site of Harley Hall?
It may be.
Well, then, is it not a fact that when Hank Jenkins died by violence, his ghost assumed existence? That it was then doomed to haunt the site of its slaying throughout eternity?
I have no knowledge of that.
Perjury is a criminal offense, Mr. Jenkins. Do you deny that you are the ghost of Hank Jenkins?
Why, certainly.
You are a ghost, are you not?
I'm an entity on the astral plane. I am not aware that I was ever a human being.
Very well. Very well. Whatever you are, answer me this question. Can you pass through a wall?
Why, yes, certainly.
Could you be bound by any physical means? Would handcuffs hold you, or ropes, chains, prison walls, a hermetically sealed steel chest?
Physical barriers mean nothing to me, by and large.
Very good. Very good. I claim, Your Honor, that the so-called Henry Jenkins has no legal status as a witness in court. There is clearly no value in understanding the nature of an oath if a violation of the oath can bring no punishment in its wake. The statements of a man who can perjure himself freely have no worth. I demand they be stricken from the record.
I had anticipated this, Your Honor. Now, I have here a list which I am prepared to deliver to the bailiff of the court of the various methods of confining an astral entity to a restricted area for periods varying from a few moments to all eternity. Moreover, I have also signed a bond for $5,000 prior to the beginning of the trial, which I stand ready to forfeit should my client be confined and make his escape if found guilty of any misfeasance as a witness.
The court is satisfied with the statement of the counsel for the plaintiff. There seems no doubt that the plaintiff can be penalized for any misstatements, and the motion of the defense is therefore denied.
All right. That will be all.
You may step down, Mr. Jenkins.
Your Honor, I would like to place in evidence these notes. The diary of the late Zebulon Harley. It was presented to my client by Harley himself last fall. I call particular attention to the entry for April 6, 1917, in which he mentions the entry of the United States into the First World War and records the results of a series of 11 pinochle games played with a personage identified as Old Hank, and in one extremely significant passage as Old Invisible.
I would like to know if the counsel for the plaintiff is in possession of any diaries after 1920.
Harley apparently never kept a diary apart from the 4 years represented in this.
Then I demand that the court refuses to admit this diary as evidence on two counts. In the first place, the evidence presented is frivolous. The few vague and unsatisfactory references to Jenkins nowhere specifically described him as what he is. A ghost. Astral entity or what you will. Secondly, the evidence, even if the first point were overlooked, concerns only the years up to 1921. The case concerns itself with the supposed occupation of Harley Hall by the so-called Jenkins in the last 30 years. That is, since 1921. Clearly, Your Honor, the evidence is irrelevant.
The reference to Old Invisible is far from vague. It is a definite indication of the astral character of my client. Furthermore, evidence as to the friendship of my client with the late Mr. Zebulon Harley before 1921 is entirely relevant, as such a friendship, once established, would naturally be presumed to have continued indefinitely. The diary is submitted as evidence. I rest my case.
Harley! There you are.
Yeah.
Looker's here.
Well, hello, Harley. Mr. Nichols.
Yep. Come and sit down.
Well, how's the trial going?
Ask Wilson. He's the lawyer. He's supposed to know these things.
Just what are you implying, Harley?
Gentlemen, let's not bicker. Suppose you answer my question.
I'm afraid the judge is on the other side. If you'd listened to me and stalled until another judge came along...
I had no time to stall. I have to be elsewhere in a few days. Even now, I should be on my way. Look, do you think we might lose the case?
Well, there's a good chance, yes.
I see. Well, perhaps I chose the wrong lawyer.
I'm what? Sure you did. I'm going to go get drunk.
Well, before you do, Harley, listen, and you too, Wilson. I've put up the money for this. I had hoped you'd be able to handle a legal end, and I see I'll have to do more. Now, listen carefully, because I have no intention of repeating this. There's an angle to this case that's escaped you completely. Now, Jenkins claims to be an astral entity, which he undoubtedly is. Now, instead of trying to prove him a ghost and legally dead, and therefore unfit to testify, as you have been trying to do, suppose you try to do this.
Your name is Russell Joseph Harley.
It is.
You are the nephew of the late Zebulon Harley, who bequeathed you the residence known as Harley Hall.
I am.
I offer this copy of the late Mr. Zebulon Harley's will and evidence. All his possessions are left to his nephew and only living kin, the defendant.
The plaintiff in no way disputes the defendant's equity in Harley Hall.
You passed part of your childhood at Harley Hall, did you not? And visited as a grown man on occasion?
I did.
At any time, has anything in the shape of a ghost, specter, or astral entity manifested itself to you in Harley Hall?
No, I'd remember it.
Did your uncle ever mention any such manifestation to you?
Him? No.
That's all. Your witness.
When, Mr. Harley, did you last see your uncle before his death?
It was in 1938, in September, sometime around the 10th or the 11th of the month.
I see. How long a time did you spend with him?
Just the one day.
When before that did you see him?
Well, not since I was quite young. My parents moved to Pennsylvania in 1920.
Yeah, and since then, except for that one day in 1938, has any communication passed between your uncle and yourself?
No, I guess not. He was a rather queer duck, solitary, a little bit balmy, I think.
Well, you're a loving nephew. But in view of what you just said, does it sound surprising that your uncle never told you of Mr. Jenkins? He never had much chance to, did he?
Well, he had a chance in 1938, but he didn't.
I'm finished, Your Honor.
Has the defense any further witnesses?
Yes, Your Honor. I would like to call Mr. Henry Jenkins to the stand.
You mean you wish to call the plaintiff as a witness for the defense?
Yes, Your Honor.
Call Henry Jenkins.
Tell me, Mr. Jenkins, just how many astral entities, I believe that is what you call yourself, are there?
I have no way of knowing. Many billions.
And all these billions are constantly about us everywhere but remaining invisible. Is that it?
Oh, no. Very few remain on Earth. Of those, still fewer have anything to do with humans. Most humans are quite boring to us.
I would like to know the significance of these questions.
I am trying to elicit some facts of major value, Your Honor. This may change the entire character of the case. I ask your patience for a moment or two.
Counsel for the defense may continue.
Now, the contention of your counsel is that the late Mr. Harley allowed an astral entity to occupy his home with his full knowledge and consent. That strikes me as being entirely improbable. But shall we, for the moment, assume it to be the case?
Certainly. It's the truth.
Uh-huh. Now tell me, Mr. Jenkins, have you a photograph of yourself, or specimens of your handwriting, or any sort of material identification? Have you any of these?
What do you mean?
I mean, can you prove that you are the astral entity alleged to have occupied Zebulon Harley's home? Can you prove that you are anyone in particular?
Your Honor, my client's identity was never in question.
It is now. The opposing counsel has presented a personage whom he styles Henry Jenkins. Well, who is this Jenkins? What is he? Is he even an individual? Let him bring in identifying witnesses who have known both ghosts and are prepared to swear that these ghosts are the same ghost. Now, failing this, there is no case.
Mr. Turnbull, have you anything to say? The argument of the defense would seem to have every merit with it.
This thing has gone far enough. I believe I can present proof that will satisfy the court.
Mr. Jenkins, you are under oath. Proceed.
Mr. Harley here spoke of a visit to his uncle in 1938. I can vouch for that. They spent a night and a day together. They weren't alone. I was there. Perhaps I shouldn't have eavesdropped as I did, but old Zeb never had any secrets from me anyhow. Young Harley was working for a bank in Philadelphia at the time. His first big job. He needed money, and needed it bad. There was a shortage in his department. A woman named Sally...
Hold on! This has nothing to do with the identification of yourself. Now keep to the point.
Your Honor, my client must be allowed to speak.
Let me remind counsel for the defense that this is his own witness. Mr. Jenkins, continue.
As I was saying, the woman's
Shut
name...
Shut up, was... damn you! Oh, he's twisting it. Make him stop, Your Honor. Sure, I knew my uncle had a ghost. He's it, all right. Curse him, and he can have the house if he wants it. I'll clear out. I'll clear out of the whole damn state.
Don't take it so hard, Harley. You lost the case, but you've still got your life.
Yeah.
Well, I have a few more minutes, and then I really must be off. Harley, I have a motto that you would do well to remember at times like this, and I'll make you a present of it if you like.
Well, what is it?
The worst is yet to come.
What gets me is, why didn't they come to us before the trial? With all that stuff about this charmingly illicit client you wished on me, we could have settled out of court.
They had their reasons. After all, one case of exorcism more or less doesn't matter. But lawsuits set precedents. Mm-hmm. Well, you're a lawyer of sorts, Wilson. Do you see what I mean?
Precedents?
Ah, I see you understand me. From now on, in this state, and by virtue of the full faith and credence clause of the Constitution, in every state in the country, a ghost has a legal right to haunt a house.
Good Lord.
Tell me, Nichols, what's your angle in all this, huh?
Think about it a while. You'll begin to understand.
My God! What's happened?
He's vanished.
That was Legal Rites by Isaac Asimov and James Maccreag, with Ed Bishop as Harley, Phil Brown as Gimble, Blaine Fairman as Nichols, and Barry Denon as Jenkins. Wilson was played by Harry Taub, and Turnbull by Bob Sessions. Sound balance was by Graham Harper. That was a BBC World Service drama production directed by Derek Hodinott.